Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. Hope you guys are all doing really well. So for today's video, I wanted to share with you guys how I became a bank risk manager by the age of 24 and give you guys a little bit of a rundown, a little bit of a history lesson as to what I did for, you know, for my study and work to sort of lead me up until this point in my career where I am currently a risk manager at one of the big four banks in Australia. Now, I just wanted to preface this video by saying that everyone's journey is different. Everyone follows a different path in their careers, you know, during their time. So I don't want this to be, you know, a video about me sort of bragging that, you know, I've reached a bank manager position or risk manager position at the age of 24, because everyone is essentially on their own path and people take their own times to get to places. And this may not even be something that you would like to achieve early on or later on in your life. Just wanted to make sure I say that in case I do offend anyone and be like, this is the way to do it, because no, this isn't the way. It depends on what you want to do in your life and how you want to perform and the way that you just want to live your life. So I'm just gonna get started and give you guys a little bit of a history. I have mentioned this in a lot of my videos before, but I think I'll get into the nitty-gritty detail, give you my, you know, study and work life sort of history, what I exactly did to sort of lead me up until this point where I am able to say that I was able to be a risk manager by the age of 24. I'm currently 25, so I started this position mid last year. So yeah, let's just begin. Hey guys, hope you're enjoying today's video. I just quickly wanted to pop on and introduce today's sponsor, DataCamp. So DataCamp is an online learning platform focused on data science with bite-sized lessons so you can actually learn anywhere you like and from anywhere just on your device. It allows for easy data science or manipulation, which is easy for everyone, whether you're looking at learning new skills around something simple like Excel or even more advanced programs. So this day and age in the corporate world, understanding and analyzing data is considered to be very critical, no matter what industry you're in. So with DataCamp, you're able to learn data science today and essentially apply it tomorrow in your day-to-day work. You're able to acquire skills faster, and especially because there's over 300 courses available on this platform, you're able to combine video classes along with, you know, test examples and, you know, exercises to really help guide you and understand, you know, all about data science. So if you're interested, a DataCamp subscription starts at only $25 per month, and that gives you unlimited access to the courses. So I encourage you, if you are looking to sort of step it up a little bit at work and pick up a new skill and really demonstrate that, then I encourage you to click on the link in the description box below and check out the first chapter of any course for free. So that's it guys, if you're interested in learning more about this, then definitely click on the link below and let's just continue on with today's video. So I started university in the year 2013. I started doing a Bachelor of Commerce majoring in economics and commercial law. So that was essentially a 3-year degree, but it ended up being 4 years for me because I wasn't academically, you know, switched on. I wasn't very studious. So it took me a little bit longer, but I did get there in the end, just getting a pass average. So I wasn't very much a studious person. I would do the bare minimum when it came to my studies. I wasn't academically inclined and I didn't actually like going to uni, but I did know that, you know, choosing a commerce degree was sort of a well-rounded degree. I could really fit into any sort of, you know, business position. I knew that I wanted to do something, you know, either business, law, accounting, risk, something like that. So I chose a commerce degree because I feel like it's quite broad and it's very accepted as well within the communities. So I was also the type of person that would attend uni, but just for the sole purpose of attending uni. I didn't stay back after, I didn't socialize much. I was like in and out straight away because I was also working at the time as well. And I just wanted some downtime by, you know, coming home, relaxing, etc. So I wasn't really active, you know, in terms of uni events, you know, doing volunteering at uni, being part of the societies, etc. I wasn't really heavily involved in that. And I think that sort of worked better for my schedule anyway, because I was also working, but we'll get into that a little bit later. So I essentially graduated in the year 2017. I completed in 2016. So 2013 to 2016, that was 4 years, but my graduation took place the year after in April 2017. Now let's just get into a little bit about the work history side of things. That's what I studied. Now in in terms of work, I started working at the age of 14. So my first job was at my dad's restaurant. So he had an Indian dine-in and takeaway restaurant, which I would very regularly assist him in. So at this point, I was actually still in high school. I think I was in year 9 or year 10, and that's when I started helping out my dad at the restaurant. I would be the person to take orders, you know, go to the tables. I would do phone orders. I'd process credit cards. At the time, you know, I used to get the signature and, you know, input like sometimes like the full card number in case the system was down, etc. So I would be a part of that, taking orders face to face and even serving the food as well. So I was essentially a waitress. So I feel like for me to sort of get involved in that kind of work very early on, develop those sort of, you know, communication skills, confidence, talking to people. And I think that really put me in a good position because as a person, I'm actually very shy. Not anymore, but previously I used to be very shy, very sort of closed off and very hesitant, very conservative, very reserved, and I would be afraid to talk to people. So I think that was a really good way for me to sort of come out of my shell and really develop as a person. So super thankful that my dad did have that restaurant open because I was very heavily involved in that. That would be almost a 3 to 4 times a week sort of thing. So after, you know, high school, I would finish at about 3 p.m. and it would be like straight to the restaurant, which is sort of near the city. So I feel like that was a good thing that sort of molded me into developing those skills quite early on. Now, as I got older, obviously HSC was approaching. So HSC is our, you know, final year board exams in year 12. So as that sort of got closer, we sold the restaurant and that gave me a lot of time to just focus on my studies. Even though I feel like that was somewhat of an excuse to tell my dad to sell the restaurant, because even then I'm still not very academically inclined. But yeah, I did stop working when it did come to about year 11 and year 12, because I was like, you know, it's heads down, bums up kind of thing, and you gotta, you know, focus and prepare for your HSC result. So yeah, I wasn't working during my high schooling years. Now, once high school was over, I obviously transitioned into university, and that was in 2013. And in my first year of starting university, my parents were like, I think it's now time for you to get a job just so that you are able to develop those communication skills more, build that confidence, you know, those talking abilities, being a little bit more open with how you sort of present yourself. So dad was the main sort of pushing force or the driving force behind this. My younger brother had actually already started working, and he's actually 2 years younger than me. So he was working at a pizza shop, and because I was in my first year, I was like, you know, I need to get into the workforce. I need to develop those skills, because then the longer I delay it, the harder it is for me to sort of become that kind of well-rounded person. So I ended up joining that pizza shop as well. I started taking, I was mainly responsible for taking orders, preparing the pizzas, phone calls, and like stocking up things as well. So that was sort of my main duties, again, around that sort of waitressing side of things. So I was there at the pizza shop for about a year. I became very, very comfortable. I was, you know, very comfortable around the people that I worked with. I had developed some really good friendships, and I was sort of in my groove and I was happy with where I was. I was very comfortable, very much in my comfort zone. And this is when dad was like, okay, so you need to like leave that place now. You need to figure out something else to do, because you've been there for a year and you've been doing the same sort of work for some time now, and I think it's time for you to move on and develop additional skills, things outside of hospitality, and more so, you know, inclined with the line of study that you are sort of pursuing, that being business, comm law, etc. I then went ahead and I started applying for a few jobs on my own accord, and I ended up working also at the pizza shop, but I did also apply for a Christmas period, Maya, which is a very large retail department store here in Australia. I ended up applying for that during the Christmas period, and I had a retail job where I was in the women's handbag section, and that was my job for about, I think actually 6 months. I did that for 6 months whilst also working at the pizza shop as well, because the pizza shop, I wasn't having many, you know, shifts that time. So I was able to pick up more shifts, you know, at Maya. Maya was really good because there were a lot of customers, and it's more sort of selling as well. Even though we didn't have any sales targets or commissions like that, it was really, you know, hands-on, and it just provided a different perspective to how things work. And I think every sort of person has sort of worked in the retail field before, and that's sort of where you start off, where you learn those, you know, those early skills. It's sort of just the first thing that you do, you know, sort of when you're at uni or coming out of high school, that you do, and you work at a retail store. So a lot of my friends did the same thing as well. Now, it was all well and good. I was happy at the pizza shop. I had my few shifts there, and I was working at Meijer as well. But then I was like, you know what? I need to do something that's sort of in line with what I'm studying. So then I started applying for law firms and internships, and I was willing to do anything for sort of for free, just so that I could gain that experience and have something written on my resume. So I started applying. So I ended up getting a position at a law firm, very local law firm, and I was there for, I think, twice a week. I used to go there during the daytime, which was good because Meijer and the pizza shop was sort of nighttime. So I was able to, you know, work my schedule around that whilst I was still at uni as well. So a few things going on, which was sort of good because at uni, I would just go to my classes, and sometimes I wouldn't even go. I'd just watch my lectures online if I knew I had a lot of work to do that day. But yeah, I was working essentially three jobs at the same time whilst I was at uni. It was good that my schedule for uni wasn't pretty hectic. It wasn't actually hectic. I was only, I think, required to be at uni maybe 2 or 3 days a week. So that gave me a lot of time to do other things as well, which I thought was really good, because I know a lot of the other students in like law or med or whatever it is, they have to go to uni 5 days a week, and it's a pretty full-time schedule. So I was pretty fortunate that my degree didn't require that. So yeah, I had joined the law firm. I was essentially being trained to become a paralegal, doing those kind of duties, researching, going to court, answering phone calls, etc., preparing cases, case summaries, file notes, etc., etc. So all of those, you know, paralegal kind of things. So I was very happy with that because I felt like I was actually doing something that was related to my degree, and I didn't want my degree to go to waste. You know, I was studying all of this and I was like, you know, I want to do something and actually work towards it. So I'm pretty happy with that. Made some pretty awesome friends along the way. Learned a lot. I feel like I learned a lot of those professional skills, and I think it was quite relevant because I was looking to develop and move into more corporate fields of work. So I was really happy that this was a good sort of stepping stone into that. So for a good time, I think for about a good 6 to 8, 9 months, I was doing those three jobs whilst I was at uni. Now, it obviously all became a bit too much. Now, it all obviously became very repetitive. I became, again, very comfortable in my skin, very comfortable around the people, around the work that I was doing. So this is when I thought it was now the time to move up a step and time to sort of look at jobs that were really in line with my field of work. And I've always wanted to work at a bank, so I started looking at bank jobs. I had no sort of professional experience besides the law firm and those 2-3 retail jobs that I did, but I thought I would give it a shot, and I applied for a bank role within customer service, and this was a sort of call center type of job. So I would essentially be responsible for opening up bank accounts, providing balances, credit cards, general information on home loans, and just the basic sort of customer care needs that, you know, any person would pick up and call the bank for. So I applied for that job, and thankfully and luckily I got in, which I was so happy about. The interview process and all the online questionnaires were pretty tough. I remember there were a few rounds, so I was pretty happy that I did get in. Now, once I got this job, I obviously quit everything else because I could not manage all four jobs. So I quit all of the others, the pizza shop, Meijer, and the law firm as well, just to focus on this banking job. So I can say I was working at CBA because I don't work there anymore. So I was working at CBA, and I feel like I was so happy because I finally got into a bank, and that's something that I've always obviously wanted to do, getting a job within that corporate field. Now, I was in the customer service role for about I think a year and a half, almost 2 years, and I was again becoming very comfortable with my work, and again I was just so familiar with how everything worked And I was like, okay, now is the time to sort of look into other things within the bank and maybe do a transfer, because I felt like I had gained all the experience and knowledge that I wanted to. I mean, I could become a team member, I could have become a, you know, a supervisor, etc. But I don't think that was something that I was really, really passionate about. I then figured out that I wanted to do something within risk, but I felt like I was still at uni, I didn't have a full understanding, I didn't have a degree, so no one would actually take me within the risk field. So even though I applied, I didn't get through. But I did end up then transferring within the bank to a business banking type of role. This again within the call center environment. This was more so around the merchant FPOS terminals and repairing and servicing of those. Again, it wasn't something that I was super interested in, but I just wanted to get into a different sort of field of work. And I forgot to mention that at the customer service job, I was a casual worker, but I was doing about, I think, 37 hours at least. So I was picking up a fair few shifts and I tried to maintain that because, you know, I had a lot of time during uni as well. It wasn't like I wanted to be at uni, I wanted to get like higher distinctions, like distinctions. I was just there pretty like cruising along. I was happy with a pass or a credit, and I felt like that additional sort of work experience on the side of uni as well, I think is very, very important, just to showcase that you are able to multitask and you are able to sort of manage the two things, I think is very important. In fact, I think work experience is actually more important than your actual degree. So I put a lot of importance on my work as well, making sure that my studies obviously weren't being affected. So this business banking role that I did end up joining was actually a full-time role. So I was actually required to do, around the 40 hours. So I was obviously under the pump, and at this point I had changed my uni classes to nighttime classes. So every time I would go to work, each day, 5 days a week, I would then have to go to uni straight after. I mean, it was pretty hectic, but I think at this point I was actually in my last semester or last two semesters of uni. So I was about to finish, and towards the end, I didn't leave too many subjects for me to, you know, have to complete. I left it a little bit flexible. I think I only had two in the last semester, and I think it was only three in the second last semester. So I sort of planned it that way as well, just so that I could also focus on work and also, you know, get uni done on the side as well. So I thought that was very important for me to manage both of them at the same time. Now, I was within this business banking role, I think, for about 6 months, and I was quickly becoming tired of it because I figured it wasn't something that I wanted to, you know, wanted to do long term, and my degree was sort of coming to an end, and I was like, okay, so this is the time now to apply for a graduate position. So as any other uni student, I ended up applying for the big four accounting firms, EY, Deloitte, KPMG, PwC. I applied to all of the banking graduate programs, all of the big four banks in Australia, because I was like, I'm gonna take ownership of myself and I want to get into something, get into the line of work that is most relevant to my degree. I actually want to use my degree. And luckily I landed a job at KPMG. So I had gotten the KPMG graduate program. I was in the intake for 2017 and I was over the moon. I was so happy. And I obviously gave in my resignation at CBA. And I didn't actually quit CBA. I think it was only a month before I started KPMG. So I was like to my employer, look, I've found this role. I think it's better suited to my career goals. And this is actually what I want to do in life, because I had gotten a role within risk consulting. And I was like, wow, this is like perfect. So I definitely took up the opportunity and I worked up until 1 month before I had to start KPMG. I could have taken longer, but I felt like, you know, I still did want to make the money. I still did want to get that experience. And I didn't know what else to do in that time anyway. So I was like, I'll work, but I'll take 1 month off because this is it. Once I start working at KPMG, I would work until, you know, the next 50, 60 years of my life. And I just wanted to take that 1 month break and just take that time off because I knew that this would be my life for the rest of my life at least. So I did take that time off. I don't know what I did. I don't remember, but I feel like I was just going out and meeting with friends and just chilling and soaking up as much sort of sleep. And I knew that I wasn't going to get enough sleep. So I was sleeping a lot. I was just enjoying life. Then come to KPMG. I was there for about 2.5 years. So the first year was just a graduate position. You hold that position for a year and then become an actual consultant. So I was pretty happy working at KPMG. I was over the moon that I had gotten this position because applications are really tough, and only four people sort of made it through for my cohort. They only hired four people out of thousands of applications that were sent through. So I was really, really happy and really fortunate that I had actually made it through. My role at KPMG involved, you know, I was in internal audit, looking at controls, process mapping, risks, and really sort of building strategies for clients and assessing their controls and policies and procedures, all of that good stuff. So I was really happy. I picked up some really, you know, key things, key skills in identifying risk and the basics and fundamentals of risk governance, and just really understanding that to a really good level. So this is when I thought, okay, I was ready to leave KPMG and move into the industry. And fortunately enough, I actually had a secondment opportunity while I was at KPMG at one of the big four banks, which I now currently work at. So I had an opportunity to work at the bank for, I think, 3 to 4 months. So still working for KPMG, but I was seconded out to the bank. Now, I was seconded out to a business assurance type role, and I was really happy in that. I was like, you know, this is actually quite doable. I mean, when I did start working at that job, I was like, wow, this is actually really different to what we do at KPMG. Because at KPMG, I feel like we just touch the surface of a lot of the reviews that we do. Whereas at the bank, they do a full deep dive. They look at design effectiveness, they look at operating effectiveness, and it's a much more detailed way of testing things. So, I mean, the secondment was over, it was all well and good. And then the following year, I had actually got hit up by a recruiter. So I happily took that position. It was at the same bank that I did the secondment for, and it was actually within the consumer assurance division. So I was like, this is actually perfect. Like, consumer means like mortgages, home loans, credit cards, deposits, etc. I felt like this was so relatable. We are consumers, you know, in everyday society. And I was like, okay, if I'm going to be within the risk division for consumer, I felt like this was just so perfect because it'll be so relatable and it'll be a good insight into the bank and how the bank works. And again, as you do leave the industry, there are a few advantages. Obviously, the pay is higher, the hours are better, and there's more routine, there's more structure to how things work. So I felt like I had developed a lot of good skills at KPMG, a lot of fundamental skills. I feel like that was a really good stepping stone into sort of furthering my career. And I learned a lot of the basic things. And having done that secondment opportunity, I think was a very good insight into what the outside world, what the industry world looks like and how that actually operates. So I felt like I had a really good understanding of what I was sort of getting myself into. So this is how I sort of ended up landing that the risk manager position. It also goes to say that the team that I'm working in, there aren't any analysts or no senior analysts, and they do start from the manager up. So being a manager, I'm not actually managing employees, I'm actually managing a portfolio. And obviously we have a lot of, you know, stakeholder engagement. We are required to do everything ourselves. So just to give you guys a little bit of context, so at KPMG, I was a consultant. I was a consultant for 2.5 years, and I was actually almost ready to become a senior con, but I left just before that. And for me to sort of leave a consultant role before having been a senior con and then moving up to a manager role, I feel like it's somewhat of a two-level sort of jump, because I've obviously bypassed that middle role and I've gone to manager. So very fortunate to have done that. Now, reflecting back, now that I think about everything, I mean, I think it really makes sense. The decisions that I've taken, the steps that I've taken have sort of landed me in the position that I am today. I feel like all of the roles, all of the jobs that I was involved in were sort of good stepping stones, and I was sort of leveraging all those roles, gaining all the experience, all the knowledge that I could to sort of push me further and quicker into my career. I mean, I could actually have stayed at the one job for, you know, until I became partner, but that's not me as a person. I get very bored of jobs very, very quickly, and I feel like for me, it's essentially 2 to 3 years that I feel like are the main learning fundamental years where you sort of grow as a person. And I feel like if you're at a job, if you're in a role for like, you know, 2 to 3 years, I feel like you've learned everything that you could have. I mean, I could be wrong. And then you would sort of work your way up the corporate ladder. I mean, yes, you could be like a team manager, a supervisor, but essentially the work is the same. The people are the same, and you know exactly everything inside out. So for me to stay in a position for more than 2 or 3 years, I feel like is not the right decision for me, because I feel like the work will become very routine, very mundane, and that is why I as a person I like to move around. So yeah, I like being challenged, I like, you know, being thrown into the deep end, I like learning new things, meeting new people, changing the environment up a little bit, and that is why I left KPMG. So I feel like, yeah, if you stay in the same sort of position for, you know, more than 2 years, I mean, yes, you can work up the corporate ladder, but I feel like if you were to sort of, you know, jump from job to job, like every 2 to 3 years, I feel like your progression in life, your progression in your career would be a lot quicker as well. I mean, I could have stayed at KPMG, I could have been a senior consultant, but no, I've sort of, you know, 10x that, and I've sort of jumped into a banking role, which has sort of landed me a manager position. So I bypassed that completely. Now, if I was to stay here for another, you know, few years, then I could move on to a different sort of division or a different organization, and I could become a senior manager. I'm not saying that I'm going to do that, but that's what, you know, the future could look like. Instead of me staying at KPMG, then become manager for 3 years, then, you know, associate director, director, and then partner. So I think this sort of method works well for me, you know, by leveraging the skills that you have at your previous job to sort of catapult you into your next job and catapult you into a position that is one or two levels higher than your previous one. Now, a few other things that I did want to mention, a few attributes that I felt like, that I feel like have sort of molded me as a person, are the extracurricular activities that I did do at uni. So I was doing a few things at uni, but alongside that, I was also a very, very keen tennis player as well. I was very enthusiastic, and I actually did want to become professional, but that idea just went out the window. Instead, I did actually get involved in dancing. So I was involved in Bollywood and Punjabi dancing. You guys know I was a part of a Bhangra team. So we were sort of very heavily involved into like competitions. I feel like, you know, being involved in something different, especially a team sport, really sort of molds you as a person to be a team player. I think the fact that I was doing so much, I mean, I was working, I was studying at the same time, I was a part of a dance group. I feel like this also all came through in the interviews that I did as well. The employers were able to see that I'm a very well-rounded person. I've got a lot of things. I'm able to multitask. I can manage a few things at the same time. I can work under pressure and still sort of maintain a very sound level of, you know, performance in my life as well. So yeah, I think it showed that I was a very sort of proactive person. I really drived my career, really pushed myself, and this is how I've sort of landed the position that I am today. I think this sort of builds that character as well. It shows that I am very eager to learn, I'm eager to progress and, you know, get further in life by taking ownership of my own actions. I think if you are like me and you do want to sort of, you know, get to this position, then I do recommend sort of starting early, getting in there quickly. I think if you start early and you set yourself some goals, you'll be able to, you know, get through quicker in life if that's what you're interested in. You're able to get there quicker, you're able to learn more and really develop as a person. I think also if you're at uni as well, I think if you've got the time, then definitely be involved in, you know, doing some paid work just as experience, or if not, doing internships as well. And like cadetships is very, very useful. I think you should always just try to sort of balance the two. It's not always like, you know, study, 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 that will get you to your goal position. I feel like having a balance of the two is very important. It's also like, you know, when you go for interviews as well, your employer is always asking you, you know, what prior experience do you have? You can't just say that, no, I don't have any experience, I've just been studying all the time. I mean, if you've got the time and, you know, if you want to be in this field, I know it's not very heavy, the schedule for uni is not very heavy, so you will have some time. I know definitely in Australia, you will have time, so take up that time, take up a job, do an internship, and really like leverage those skills. Even if you are working for free, leverage it, because that is what will make you sort of get that end position quicker. So yeah, just don't put your eggs into one basket. Don't just be studying, you know, get involved in some work, part-time or full-time work, whatever it is, casual work even. At least you've got something there on your resume to show to your potential employer that, look, I was also studying, but I was working as well. And I feel like that would definitely put you up here a little bit, as opposed to everyone that's just, you know, studying. But yeah, that's essentially everything that I wanted to talk through. I hope you guys found this very informative, useful, helpful. And if you've got any other questions, any other, you know, burning sort of suggestions or anything at all, then definitely leave a comment down below, or you can send me an email as well if that works better for you. But yeah, that is essentially everything that I wanted to talk through and how I landed the position where I am here today. I am very grateful that I have taken those steps and those decisions early on in my life to be able to be, you know, financially comfortable and have that peace of mind that, you know, I did reach a position a little bit quicker than the rest of, you know, the cohort that I'm with, if I was to compare. But yeah, that's all I wanted to share with you guys today. If you like this video, then please give it a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe to my channel down below, and I shall see you guys in my next video. Thanks, guys.